Until he signals us. Shabbat Shalom, everybody.
Shabbat Shalom.
Welcome to Ruach Adonai, the Spirit of God. I'm Dr. Barry Kraft, and this is my lovely wife, Fran. We co-pastor Ruach Adonai in Thousand Palms, California. We meet every Friday night at 7 at Desert Christian Community Church.
We just want to wish you all a very, very happy holiday, a safe holiday, and just keep remembering to pray for Israel and the people over there suffering on both sides. So make it a good holiday. We never know when something can happen to end our ability to worship and to celebrate the holidays we're used to.
We're going to welcome in the service with the blowing of the shofar and the lighting of the Shabbos candles. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kedeshanu V'Hinam Yeshua HaMashiach V'Tzibonu Shema Kol Shofar. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with the blood of Yeshua the Messiah, and has commanded us to hear the call of the shofar. Amen.
Amen. Soldiers over there right now, and one for Israel.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kedeshanu B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu Lehiyot Or Lagoyim V'Natan Lanu Et Yeshua HaMashiach Or Ha'olam. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with thy commandments and sent us to be a light to the nation, and gave us your Son Yeshua to be a light to the world. Amen.
Michael will be leading us in the Shema and the Vyaha.
Nice day
I looked
there.
I know. Although I was kind of enjoying it. Boy.
You love me that much.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kavod, Malchuto Leolam. Bevarta pam, beshita, bebeteka. ובלכה בדרך ובשופתה ובקומקה ובשרתם לאות על ידך והיו לתותפות בין עיניך וכתבתם על מזוזות ביתך ובשעריך. And ye shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. And these words which I command you this day shall be on your heart, and ye shall teach them to your children, and speak of them when ye sit in your house, and when ye walk by the way, and when ye rise up. Ye shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and to be frontlets between your eyes. And ye shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Viahata loreka kamoka, and ye shall love your neighbor as yourself. Upon these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen.
Thank you.
That's one of my favorite things.
We become a quadruple here. Okay, that's good. Ready?
Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, Shabbat 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 shalom. Hey! Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, Shabbat 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 shalom. Shabbat shabbat, Shabbat shabbat shalom, Shabbat shabbat. Shabbat shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, Shabbat 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 shalom.
Hey! Such spirit, that's great. And now for the prayer before the reading of the Torah portion of Parasha. Baruch Hu Adonai Melech Haolam, Baruch.
Bless the Lord who is blessed. Bless the Lord who is forever blessed. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from among the peoples and has given us the Torah. Blessed are you, Adonai, giver of the Torah. Amen.
And now it gives me great pleasure to call up Max who's doing the parasha this week. I didn't have to twist his arm too far. He is a good volunteer, and he actually said, I enjoyed it.
You know, it's good to get into the Word, right? Yes. And dig deep.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello.
You know, some people say that there's inconsistencies in the Word of God, but what I saw from these three separate passages, thousands of years apart, is how consistent they talk about the same thing, all three, in different variations.
Yes.
So Genesis 25:19 through 28:9 is the first portion. It speaks of Isaac's sons, Esau and Jacob. They were twins at war. It was a war zone even in the womb. Two nations, and the older would serve the younger. Esau was the youngest with the rightful birthright as the oldest, but Jacob tricked Esau into taking his birthright. It was part of God's plan, even though Jacob handled it wrong. God uses what the devil meant for bad, for good. God often goes against what we feel should be the order and does something unconventional. Unconventional by allowing the youngest to be the lineage of the nation of Israel. Isaac moved into a new land with his wife Rebecca. He lied to the men of the country and said that she was his sister out of fear that he would be killed. Here he was dishonest and rebellious to God, but yet the king, Amalek, wanted to honor God out of fear. He was very upset, saying, the men of my country could have slept with her, and it would have brought guilt on our nation from God. Though it was the Philistines, a nation that did not serve God, the king saw God's power and did not want to cross him. Here a man of God went against his will, and the godless wanted to honor God's will. Despite that rebellion, out of fear, God ensured that Rebekah's line would be that of what would become the nation of Israel. Israel is still under God's protection to this day. He has honored his promise to make Abraham's bloodline a nation as numerous as the stars in the sky. His will is done even when we go against his plans. Later on, God told Isaac, do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless your descendants. How good is God to be patient with us despite our flaws? Isaac built an altar to God after that word. This showed that even though Isaac made a mistake, he was faithful to the Lord. He was a man after God's heart. Again, even though the king was not a follower of God, the next time that he met and came into contact with Isaac, he said, clearly we see the Lord is with you. When they wanted to take wells from Isaac, Isaac was blessed with wealth, but the king did not want to test God by trying to take his well as they tried before. He wanted a treaty that Isaac would not harm him. How much awe does God have? Yes. Now the twins' father Isaac was dying and ready to give his blessing to his eldest son. This was similar to the sibling rivalry of that of Cain and Abel. Rebecca convinced her favorite son Jacob to steal the blessing from his brother. Some speculate that our current Arab and Israeli conflict can be traced back to Esau's bitterness towards his younger brother. Rebecca said, your brother is consoling himself with the thought of killing you. Esau became a mighty warrior, but later chose to forgive Jacob. This was similar to Abraham, his grandfather, sending Hagar and Ishmael cast into the desert. Maybe the same may also be the cause of Israel's current fight. At the end of the day, God still used Abraham and Jacob's rebellion for his good to bless the nation of Israel. Maybe one of Esau's 400 men could have still held on to the bitterness as Esau felt for those years. Because of the rebellion of these men, a great nation, the Arab nation, arose against us. And though they are in the wrong, God still had compassion. Hagar was crying in the desert, and God comforted her and said, don't worry, your son will be a great nation too. Unfortunately, because of the rebellion, it's turned into a war that we face today. Malachi is the next portion, Malachi 1:1-2:7. This again touches on the fact that Jacob and Esau were polar opposites. The Lord said, was not Esau Jacob's brother? Yet I loved Jacob, but Esau I hated. And I have turned his mountains into a wasteland and Ishmael to the desert. Ishmael and Esau were both the eldest brothers, yet God used the second son for his glory. Some may say God used a weaker son in Jacob. God uses the humble, foolish things of this world to compound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound that of those that are mighty. Also in this section, and maybe that's why he uses Israel. Maybe we're weak and he's able to show his greatness through us. And that's not to put us down, it's just God uses the humble things of the world. Even Jesus himself was humble. He was not what the Jewish people expected. They expected a warrior king that would overthrow Rome, and God had a bigger plan, the salvation of our souls. For all generations, not just to overthrow the Romans. In another portion of Malachi, God has chosen the weak. In another portion, God was upset with the priests of that time. The Lord said that they were vowing to sacrifice an acceptable male of their flock, but were really sacrificing blind and crippled animals. He said, would a governor accept your sacrifice? The people were showing more respect for men in leadership than the Lord Almighty. God said his name will be great among the nations, in every place where incense and pure offerings will be brought in his name. He said, cursed is the one who cheats him with flawed sacrifices. He said, for I am a great king, and my name is to be feared among the nations. I feel the Lord is saying, I'll bless you if you give a sacrifice until it hurts, meaning it's hard giving something away to him that has value to you. We should give the first of our fruits, not what we don't care about. The Lord said, if I'm a father, where is my honor? This tells me that he is saying, don't I provide for you, bless you, nurture you, shower you with kindness, love you, show you respect as my children? He blessed them with their flock, and yet they gave him their worst. Joyce Myers has said that God has prompted her to give things away that she loves. One example was the fur coat she had just bought herself. She tried to convince God to give that person something of less value of hers in her closet. I don't blame her. It hurts to sacrifice, yet she gave something of great value and obeyed the Lord. It's okay for our flesh to want to disobey. God understands, but he wants to see our heart in the midst of wanting to disobey. If we give our best to God, he'll give tenfold, a hundredfold, a thousandfold. My mom says you can't outgive the Lord. Give till it hurts and see what God does. I also see here that God, as a loving father, was hurt by this rebellion. He was being kind and blessing his people, but was treated poorly. Yet he didn't destroy them. He warned them, but it seemed to give them a chance by talking it out with them. He is so patient with us despite his awe-inspiring power. Truly, he is a good father. My earthly father is a tough guy from the streets of New York, a man who never shied away from a fist fight pre-Christ. He used to tell me stories, and I'd say, whatever. And then about 20 years back, some of his football buddies came to visit, big bodybuilders, 6 foot and over, 200 some odd pounds. And they said, your dad was the crazy one in the neighborhood. He was the one that everybody feared. Yet, he was a gentle father with my sister and I, a man of power, yet a man of gentleness, as God is here. Here, God's feelings were hurt, and he could have just obliterated them, but instead, he talked it through with them. God did warn that he would curse their blessings for the rebellion, and a price was paid. He then gave the example of how he should be honored. He said, Levi stood in reverence and awe before God and was granted peace, a blessing. He said he made a covenant with Levi, and due to his faithfulness, he would honor that covenant, even though the people were being rebellious. He basically said, I'll be faithful to my word to Levi because of how he responded to me. So you are still under my blessing. Due to the respect for me, God said, due to Levi's heart, I will continue to bless you, and if you don't change, my blessings on you will turn to a curse, unfortunately. But again, giving them a chance. God could destroy the world by saying one word, yet he gives grace time and time again. Christ took our sins on himself despite how we all rebel. How great is God to be so long-suffering when he has the right to destroy the earth and start all over with people that would be more grateful. That goes into our New Testament readings, Matthew 10, 21 through 38. Jesus says in the end time, brother will kill brother, and that's where we are today. Father their children. Children will rebel against their children. All men will hate believers because of Christ. But if we stand firm in our faith, we will be saved. When persecuted in one place, flee to another, he said. Jesus then said, you will not finish going through the cities of Israel before I come back again. And we're starting to see the cities of Israel being at war. So he'll come back before they can get to the last city they can hide in. This is a comfort, I believe, by saying there will be an end to our persecution. I will return before we run out of places to run and hide. Of course, there will be martyrs, but we as people, as a whole, will be saved before there is no place to hide. I think this also speaks to God's faithfulness to the Jewish people. Salvation in the physical world, while for Christians and completed Jews through Christ, we have eternal salvation. Yeshua also says, we will suffer as he suffered because we represent him. He says to not be afraid of those who persecute us. So be bold for him. Declare what he has taught us out loud on the rooftops. Temporary suffering for his namesake is a drop in the bucket compared to eternal blessings we will receive for our boldness. Don't fear those that kill our bodies, but cannot kill our souls. Fear the one who can destroy both body and soul. Despite the power of God, he says he knows how many hairs are on our head. He cares for us and will be with us in suffering. Yeshua says, whoever acknowledges me before men, he will I acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before men, he I will disown before my Father in heaven. Here as in Malachi, if we bless God, he will bless us. He says, anyone who loves his earthly father more than him is not worthy of him. Just like anyone who offers him a blemished sacrifice versus a spotless sacrifice will not receive his blessing. Anyone who does not take up his cross and follow him is not worthy of him. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life, for God's sake, will find it. God does not promise a life with no trouble, but he knows the hairs on our head and will carry us through persecution. What an honor to be an martyr for Jesus. We are soldiers for God. May he grant us strength if we ever have to give our life for him. We truly must be in the last day. Our mother country is being attacked, and yet the world condemns us for standing up to our enemies. We as Yeshua's followers will see mockery, persecution, and possible death. But God will be with us in the battle. What an honor to serve him both as Jew, lovers of Jews, and most important, Christ followers. Let's stand together against evil men and the devil himself, for we serve the King of Kings. Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Torah of truth and planted within us eternal life. Blessed are you, Adonai, giver of the Torah. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now it gives me great pleasure to call on the Tefrat from New York. Come on, New York, get up. Let's hear what you got to say. In Iowa, he would walk in the streets with his fists like this. I said, Barry, it's not New York, it's Des Moines. Relax.
Thank you, friend. What I have to speak about tonight actually coincides with Max's parasha. I'm going to speak about God's favor. And Lord, I just come before you tonight, Lord, and I thank you for how you guide our steps, each step of the way. I thank you for the favor that you show us, Lord, the favor that you show us. And Lord, I just pray that you would show your favor to Israel. Show your favor to Israel as she fights the evil forces of Hamas. I pray this in Yeshua's name.
Amen.
Job 10:12 says, you have granted me life and favor, and your care has preserved my spirit. Do trials make you wonder if God really cares about you? Even in the middle of his suffering, Job knew he had to remember that it was God who gave him life and preserved his spirit. We need to ask God to show us always that he is caring for us and that he cares for us even in the midst of difficulties. This will strengthen and encourage us. He cares for us. He shows us his favor. Psalm 5:12 says, "For you, Lord, will bless the righteous with favor. You will surround him as a shield." Oh, how he loves and loves to give favor to the righteous, to the righteous, to those who follow him and walk in his spirit. Psalm 35 says, "For as his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life." There are times that he will chasten us. There are times where we'll feel that chastening. But God is a giver of favor. After he chastens, he shows us his love. Proverbs 12:2 says, "A good man obtains favor from the Lord, but a man of wicked intentions he will condemn." And Proverbs 11:27 says, "He who diligently seeks God's favor, but he who searches after evil, it shall come upon him." God's favor covers every area of our lives. By his favor, he has taken care of everything we will ever need. God's favor will change your life. And here's the news. We already have his favor. How would life look like if you were surrounded all day, every day, by God's favor? How different would things be if doors opened for you and you walked through each of them covered with his favor? How would your actions and your attitudes be in every situation? How would they be different if you knew that success lies ahead because you are one of God's favorites? Would you find the courage to lay down anxieties and fears? Of course you would. We serve a mighty God who has more than enough favor to go around. He's not short on favor. We already do have his favor. In Ephesians 2:8, it said, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God." How favored are we that he has saved us? Many Christians believe that they have to earn the favor of God, but the truth is we already have his favor. He saved us because of his favor towards us. His grace, the grace that he gives us daily, is favor. To be saved means to be protected, to be preserved, to be healed, and made whole. What favor. That is, by his favor, he is taking care of everything we can ever need. He searches our spirit, he searches our soul, searches our body, and gives us favor. The first thing you have to do before you can receive the benefits of God's favor is to know that they are yours. Then you have to receive them by faith. Believe and receive all that he has to give you. You must release your faith. Dig deep into God's word. Put the word into your heart and speak it out of your mouth. Believe it, act on it, and receive it. When you have the Lord's favor in your life, you will experience times of increased refreshing. How we all need times of refreshing. When we pray and get close to Him, we feel His presence and experience His favor. God's favor is not about a life without problems, but a life where we are equipped to handle those problems. Oh, how He equips us. C.S. Lewis once said, God, who foresaw your tribulation, has especially armed you to go through it, but not without pain, but without stain. God's favor is not a reward for our goodness, but a reflection of His goodness. God's favor has true transformative power. It is a dynamic force that brings about change. It is a divine empowerment that enables us to overcome problems. We are not victims of our circumstances. We are victors over them. God's favor is anchored in His promise. We were with Sandy the other day, and she was saying, she is victorious. She's victorious over the cancer in her body. And she knows and feels every day the favor of God that is upon her. Favor produces supernatural increases and promotions. In Genesis 39:21, it says, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy. He gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Favor produces restoration of everything that has ever, ever been stolen from you. Exodus 3:21 states, and I will give the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and it shall come to pass, then when ye go, ye shall not go empty. Favor produces honor in the midst of your adversaries. Exodus 11:3, and the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants, and in the sight of the people. Favor produces great victories in the midst of great impossibilities. Joshua 11:20 says, "For it was of the Lord to harden their hearts, that they should come against Israel in battle, that he might destroy them utterly, and that they might have no favor, but that he might destroy them, as the Lord commanded Moses." Favor produces prominence and preferential treatment. In Esther 2:17 it says, And the king loved Esther above all the women, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown upon her head and made her her queen instead of Vashti. Favor produces battle won, which you won't even fight because God will fight them for you. Psalm 44:3 says, "For they got not the land in possession by their own sword, neither did their own arm save them by their right hand, and thy arm, and the light of thy countenance became thou hast a favor with them." Favor, if God is for a purpose, you are blessed to be a blessing to someone else. God has a purpose for all the favor that he has given you. The reason you got that house in that neighborhood was because of favor. The purpose was so that you could be a light in that neighborhood. The Lord bless us with a wonderful house in Colorado Springs. And we open up that house, not just to the neighborhood, but to the public in Colorado Springs. And we invited people every Thursday night into that house. And we wanted to use that house for favor. The reason you got that job was because of favor. The purpose was that you would be a witness in that place. The reason why you received the healing was because of the favor of God. The purpose is that you would be a testimony to those that may be able to see what God has done for you. Glorify him and give them hope. Whatever you may be facing, whatever set of circumstances, look straight into that circumstance. Look into the face of that circumstance and say, "I'm a born again child of the Almighty God. He has supernatural favor that surrounds me like a shield. His grace is more than enough to deliver me out of this trouble. My faith is in God's word, and I will have victory through the favor of God." Just take a minute and look at the favor he has given each of you. Each of you, as you walk this journey through life. Thank you, Lord.
Just a few announcements. So next week we're going to be in the fellowship hall celebrating things. their annual day after Thanksgiving dinner. And so if you intend to come, please let me know and what you're going to be bringing. We have already been blessed with such unbelievable donations without us even asking. Oh, you've got, oh, look at there. Hey, nice. Good job. Give me a high five. Susie Lynette will be speaking. And the I tell you, the things that have been donated, some of them are one of a kind, beautiful. People gave from their heart, just incredible things. And we already have $380 collected. Talk about favor. We were sitting in that congregation here on Sunday, and a gentleman came over, and he said, how is it going? I said, well, I'm heavy-hearted over what's going on in the Middle East. And he gave me some words of encouragement, and then we're out in the parking lot in the car, and he comes up to the window, and he hands me $80 to go for Israel. So, we don't even have to ask anymore. People are just giving and giving and giving and giving and giving. And we're so blessed to have that. So I think it's going to be a wonderful day. Please let me know if you're coming. If you don't, I don't know, I'll have a seat for you. So we always have a lot of food, but we would like to have you come and join us and let us know. And so it's starting at 5:30, and always it's a good time. So we'll look forward to seeing you there. I think we have about 20 people, but there's always last minute people who, oh yeah, I want to come. So we're always welcoming them. And then December 8th, we're going to be having our Hanukkah party, our Hanukkah celebration, where we encourage you to bring your menorahs and we'll light them all together and we'll have a special dinner for that night. And again, talking about, once again, where the odds were against the Israelites, Persians had come, and they were just horrible people, trying to get the Israelites to take on their way of life, also the Greeks, Greek-Persian Ottoman Empire, and asking them to eat pork, and they would kill the babies, much like they're doing now, and the mother would have to wear the dead child around her neck. It was just horrible stuff. This is nothing new. This is what's going on right now. It's nothing new. So that's what we're going to be talking about, how once again, Israel was blessed to overcome such a powerful army, drove them out, the Maccabees drove them out, and I love it. So I think it'll be an interesting evening, and we look forward to seeing you. And that's all I've got to say. Mike, you want to do the sacraments? Join us afterwards, like we always. We have some food. Is your husband here? I hope he's in the kitchen. He's supposed to be here, right? Okay, we'll see.
Well, the Lord said to do this, to remember to Him. This is why we do this, and we're so thankful, Lord. We just prepare our hearts, and we just thank You for all that You've done for us, and the atonement, what we're about ready to receive, where we honor You and thank You. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam. Amen.
pray for bread from the earth. And Yeshua is our bread, bread of life. And we thank you, Lord, for giving us, going through what you suffered for us so that we can know eternity with you. How awesome that's going to be. So let's see it in the body. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri agapeh. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord, King of the universe, who bring forth fruit from the vine. And Lord, you are the vine, and we're the branches. We stand here only because of your shed blood, and that you gave freely in obedience to the Father. We're so grateful and thankful that you did that. Let us drink of this blood. L'chaim, to life.
L'chaim,
if we can all stand, we'll close with the right benediction. V'yelechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha Yisra Adonai p'nei v'lecha v'yichunecha Yisra Adonai p'nei v'lecha v'yasem echa. Peace. In the name of our Prince of Peace, our Sar Shalom.